and more harmful than capable of maintaining social peace between religious groups. In place of secularism, this view advocates development of a community-oriented understanding of hospitality, tolerance, conviviality, etc. A fourth and a very different stream consists of the communalists, or those who are the believers of political Hindutva. According to them, the state should impose a set of cultural traits that it considers nationalist, forcing a common way of life which all groups, irrespective of majorities or minorities, shall conform to. Paradoxically, the Hindutva majoritarians in India, likes of those who were responsible for the Gujarat carnage we mentioned at the beginning, ask for a uniform civil code in the country. Those opposed to these views in Hindutva rhetoric are pseudo-secularists who pamper the Muslims. The second paradox. Second, we take the paradox of caste identity and representation. Again, conventional wisdom suggests that in democracy, political identities are impermanent. And in large polities, such identities are formed to support or oppose particular candidates in elections. Such candidates, if elected, become representatives. They look after particular interests in the legislature and play important role in the making of public policies. The more appropriately they represent their constituencies and or the interests of their classes, the more they stand to gain from the possibilities of electoral renewal. While representation in any democracy involves a sense of loss for the represented. Once elected, their control on the representative is minimal. There always are opportunities for discontinuing support or shifting parties. In large complex democracies where direct participation is impossible, the calculus of such loss and retrieval of electoral agency keep the system of representation running. Castes, as many of you know, are groups in Hindu society formed on the basis of extremely inegalitarian ritual allowances and prohibition of certain practices. It has made the society almost permanently hierarchical, dividing the segments in ritually clean upper castes on the one hand and the untouchables on the other, with a mixed group of backward castes in between. The Indian constitution not only banned untouchability as a social practice, it has also given legal recognition to erstwhile untouchables by enlisting them as scheduled castes, opening possibilities for various affirmative action for these groups. In the post-colonial period, politics of electoral representation got increasingly entangled with the caste groups, so much so that the backward and scheduled castes formed their own political parties. As a result, the electoral constituencies became largely permanent. Each caste group and their own political parties began to contest for a larger pie of public resources. In this fight, the issue was not poverty or exploitation, but dignity and discrimination, in which the identification of the representatives who ostensibly represented the caste group and their respective constituencies was absolute and complete. If you belong to caste A, you will support candidate A, not because the latter will end your economic misery, but her or his victory will help ending age-old social injustice, earning dignity for your group as a whole. So even if candidate A is utterly corrupt or filthily rich, completely callous to your wretched conditions and keen only on carving as much as possible for the likes of him or her in the community, it is perfectly rational for you to support the candidate because his or her emergence, in a deep symbolic sense, stands for your own collective emergence. Representation in this sense discounts choice and impermanence. It virtually turns into extension of the self. Can we therefore call large segments of Indian democracy a form of extensive rather than a representative democracy. So, in conditions such as this, it does not matter if you are poor and your leader is given a garland strewn with ill-gotten cash, or your leader spends millions of rupees on a birthday bash, or spends several millions more to install her own statues all over the state where she governs as the chief minister. Actually, it's being done in India and Uttar Pradesh. Each of these acts, in the eye of her loyal supporters in the community, is an act that helps to enhance the prestige of the caste. When a television interviewer asked a Dalit young woman in a slum in Lucknow, the capital of Uttar Pradesh, what she makes of her caste leader's huge expenses at her birthday party, she came up with a prompt reply. This Dalit woman in the slum came up with a prompt reply. When the upper caste spend money, you don't complain. You find it not nice when one of us get the money to spend. At another level, but on similar lines, the Gujarat carnage does not cause defeat for Chief Minister Narendra Modi or the Bharatiya Janata Party, the architect of a pogrom against the Muslim minority in 2002. On the contrary, the party gets a sweeping majority in the election that follows, projecting its mission as the protection of Gujarati Asmita, or pride, in a Hindu majority state. Likewise, the student who commits suicide to advance the cause of his ethnic dream has little value for the self, independent of the cause. Third, we must also address the paradox of the centrality of the state in India. In liberal democracies, the state recedes as civil society and private entrepreneurship surge, taking over from the state even some of its public responsibilities. This surely encourages democracy by unlocking the concentration of economic and social power in a largely inflexible bureaucratic apparatus, multiplying choice available to the consumers and create room for innovation to enhance quality or cut cost of commodities and services on offer. It's important, it has been argued, to maintain the state as a reluctant arbiter, to invoke it in disputes and entrust it to monitor, so that the monopoly of wealth does not substitute the monopoly of the state. As has been suggested in a surging literature on government, the expansion of welfare since the 16th century has caused a momentous shift in the idea of sovereignty, from the state to the people, to the population, which increasingly became the raison d'etre of the state policies. In more recent times, the passage from Keynesian state welfareism to the present state of globalization is being posited as the emergence of a multi-layered structure of governance in which some of the traditional distinctions between public and private, government and business have become irrelevant. Democracy, in effect, has a tendency to minimize the centrality of the state. In India, something very different has happened. In the initial decades after independence, a planned development of the economy was undertaken to turn an impoverished nation, ravaged by centuries of colonial extraction, into a self-sufficient industrial economy. The legitimacy of the Congress Party, the charismatic leadership of Nehru, and paradoxically, a not-so-demanding population combined to make planning possible. After Nehru, plans really gave way to populism in the 1970s. And since 1980s, economic populism got entangled with the politics of caste, creating demands on the state for subsidies in defiance of mainstream economic rationality. The neoliberal turn of the economy, according to some, was a strategy to salvage the state with the help of the market forces. While India's new economy since the early 1990s has delivered an unprecedented economic growth, bringing a surge of private investment, polarization has also increased between the rich and the poor, towns and countryside, and between regions which succeeded in attracting investment and the laggards. A vast majority of India's workforce, more than 90%, as I mentioned, is in the informal sector, with virtually non-existent labor regulations. Every year, more than 2,000 indebted farmers commit suicide in each of the relatively prosperous states, such as Gujarat, Maharashtra, Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka. Such cases of extreme economic vulnerability